Yes, thank you. Somewhat on what more modest scales than what you just saw. I hope I can follow up on that to some extent. But indeed, we're staying in the dark realm by actually looking not for dark matter, but an actual image of a black hole. And well, I apologize for those who think yet another astronomy talk. Yes, it's yet another astronomy talk. You've seen these past few days that black holes actually play an important role in our understanding of the universe, and in particular, it has had an impact on information theory, where we actually, let me see if that works. It's hard to actually see that from way in the back. We have seen these connections, right? The black hole information paradox. You know, where a classical black hole destroys information which cannot happen due according to quantum mechanics, and the emergence of this concept of entropy associated with the black hole, and they are actually max entropy objects, to a holographic principle, duality, and actually concepts like paradigm shifts, potential paradigm shifts that have to do with emergent gravity or entropic gravity. And this is all caused, this revolution, by this surface, this hypothetical surface called an, well, it's an imaginary virtual surface, of course, it doesn't really exist, but it's this region in space called the event horizon, where information goes in, something goes in, nothing comes out, at least classically. And the question is, will we ever be able to see such an event horizon? And obviously, I wouldn't be standing here if the answer to that wouldn't be yes. And in particular, there are two places where we actually think that with current technology, we have the ability to see the region just immediately around the black hole, to image it, in fact. And one of them is a very active nearby galaxy. It has a powerful jet, as you can see. This, I'm only showing here the inner region. And if you go actually to much larger scales, you know, this is now 240,000 light years, which is much, much larger than our own galaxy. You can see that these jets deposit, they run into the intergalactic medium. They run into the actually into the galactic medium, really, they shock. And they deposit an enormous halo of radio emission that you can detect with a telescope like LOFAR. But this jet that actually goes out to this distance of about 240,000 light years actually originates from an incredibly small place. We're now actually zooming in to 3 light years, and you can still see the jet. And in fact, if you would have to go, you would have to go back to, you have to go down to a size of about a solar system or less to see the region where the jet is actually produced. And there we think that there is a massive black hole, a supermassive black hole. Another place where we believe we can see a black hole is actually in the center of our own galaxy. In the 1970s, it was discovered that in radio emission in the center of our galaxy, right there, there is actually a very bright source. And that has been, since then, of course, has been very active observations, research. And what has been found is that not only is there this spiral of gas around it, we can also, since the end of the 90s, observe stars, massive stars, in the center of the galaxy, and they move. They don't move in random. They actually turn out to be actually in orbit around an otherwise seemingly empty spot of space. And in particular, this star that you see outlined here has been followed from its closest approach to the black hole all around. And actually, it had another close approach a month and a half ago. Well, that is a month and a half ago, plus 26,000 years, of course, because it's 26,000 years away, light years away. But just to give you an idea of the, oops, are you still working? Yeah. Of this, I cannot tilt my head without actually disturbing the microphone. Is that still working?
Yeah.
Okay. It sounds a lot less, anyway, loud to me. So this distance of closest approach is about the solar system. It's about the distance of Pluto to the sun. So it gets incredibly close to the black hole. The black hole is, in fact, and from that we can actually calculate the mass of the black hole, and it turns out to be that there is well inside that orbit there is a mass of about 4 million solar suns, right? So 4 million solar masses, and most of that we think is in the black hole. Now these two spots, these will be the largest on the sky, the largest black holes available to us, and we want to see them. Now a black hole, the problem is, of course, it's black. It doesn't emit any radiation. But already in the 1970s, Bardeen actually calculated what would happen if a black hole goes in front of a star. And he actually calculated that there would be this region of darkness, and a region that actually looks as if there's less light coming from, and we would see it as a shadow. So we call it the shadow of the black hole. So I could have called this talk, you know, the hunt for the shadow of the black hole, but that was a little bit hunty and phantomy to the extreme. Now, in the early 90s, they calculated if you do not actually have a star behind the black hole, but you're embedded within radiation, what would you see? And you would see exactly the same type of shadow. But in this particular case, it turns out that you have to look in the radio. And the reason we have to look in the radio is actually sort of radio in that part of the electromagnetic spectrum. It's still, of course, light. We have to look there because it's not thermal radiation as in the sun, but it's non-thermal radiation, particles that actually are spiraling in very intense magnetic fields. And the characteristic is here that the closer you get to the event horizon, to the black hole, the higher the frequency of the emission will be. And it turns out it peaks in the submillimeter. And then, as you can see in the optical, which is on this right-hand side of you, and the infrared, it just drops off tremendously. So you have indeed a black hole. You don't see it there. As I said, the calculations actually show that it will see shows a shadow. And that same concept was used then here by the movie Interstellar, which shows a very interesting but slightly incorrect rendering of what you would see. So that's what we're after. Since then, things have gotten a lot more interesting. Let's see if that movie will actually start, because simulations are now much more advanced. So here you see actually a torus, so a donut of gas, and this is a side view where you slice through it, and it will start accreting. Matter will become unstable in this torus. It will start accreting, embedded, and flowing into the black hole. Embedded within this torus, there are these very intense magnetic field lines, and they get twisted. And as they get twisted and wound up, so let's go a bit slower than that. So initially, you can see the shadow part of it inside it. And you can see the field lines being twisted. We'll just give it a little bit of time. So the plasma accretes, it becomes hot, it starts shining. The shadow will the black hole event, the gravitational lensing will produce this shadow. And that's what we're trying to capture. But as the magnetic field lines in this simulation actually wind up, they become funnels. They create funnels, and these are the origins of the jets in these active galactic nuclei. Actually, you don't much see. Trust me, there are wound up lines of magnetic lines there that you, unfortunately, this rendering doesn't show you too much. And what is interesting is that indeed, when we do these calculations carefully, it turns out that we can produce pretty realistic pictures of what we actually observe. And what you see here is a simulation that is sort of oriented the same way as M87. And you can see that the simulation produces a hollow tube with most of the radiation coming from the sides of the tube. And this is also what we see. This is this edge brightened structure in M87. it shows you the it similarly shows you that the jet tube is sort of empty. Most of the radiation comes from the cone, the sides. And you can even perhaps convince yourself that these twirls you see, well, there's some evidence of twirls there, perhaps more on my screen than actually on the large screen. So what you will see is, so you see different components. At the longer wavelengths we and further out from the black hole, the radiation will mostly see the show the jets. But as you zoom in and increase the frequency, so make the wavelengths shorter, you will actually start seeing the accretion disk. And at about 230 gigahertz, so 1.3 millimeters, we will be mostly sensitive to the accretion disk. Now, there's one slight problem for Sagittarius A star, not for M87, is that we're looking through an enormous amount of material going through the to the center of our own galaxy. And this produces scattering. And unfortunately, at frequencies below about a millimeter, this scattering dominates. And so this whole, even though there is maybe a jet, nobody's ever seen a jet at Sagittarius A star, we will just see it as if it is a lamp in the fog, right? A street lamp in the fog. It's like a very diffuse amount of emission. This is exactly what we have seen. But at 1.3 millimeter, we believe that we're going to poke through this particular scattering that you can see up there, and that we will actually get a be able to get an image from the shadow. Now, another complication is that if this is sort of this shadowy image, this is the resolution that you get from an Earth-sized telescope at 1.3 millimeter. You can see you need an Earth-sized telescope to actually do that. And that, fortunately, and I won't go into the details of that, it is possible in radio astronomy to do that. It's called very long baseline interferometry. We create a virtual telescope whereby we actually, at a very high speed, we have wide bandwidth, we actually record the data at each telescope, and then we bring these disks together in a supercomputer type of setup, and we play them back as if they were observed at the same time, at that moment, from all these telescopes, and that's how we can combine the data in an image. This is quite a feat. We need a very accurate clock, so we have an atomic type of clock, a maser at each of these telescopes, we install them, and the data rate is phenomenal. We have in parallel at each telescope to keep up with the data rate, we run a we run 128 hard drives, and we need twice that at the telescopes to last us 5 days. We have 1.5 petabyte of data. And to go through this rather quickly, we've been building this up in first detection in 1998. Then trying was somewhat ignored because people didn't know the relevance, that we didn't know the mass of the black hole. But then in 2008, and I was at the JCMT telescope, we did it again. And we saw this enormous, we conclusively showed that there actually was emission from this. And we've been building up this array. We've added more telescopes and we've added sensitivity. And these are some data from 2013. And what you can see is that the data is fits better a ring model than a disk model. Now, a ring model is a bit overstated. I'll show it. The disk model here is a Gaussian. So there is a hint, certainly, that we see something that is not a Gaussian. We also know that it's asymmetric. But in fact, this model with two blobs, which are, you know, one is brighter than the other, fits equally well currently with the data as a ring model, and that is shown here. So we don't know too much about it, about the actual image. But actually, if you assume it's a ring-type model, which is kind of a model that we that the simulation tells us, we can actually go further and actually tell already quite a bit about it. And it will, if we assume it's an accretion disk that comes towards us on one side and goes away from us, then in fact, the side that will be towards us is on the on your right, and it will be oriented as shown in the center picture. So this is a very, very model dependent assumption, but you can see if we have this particular model, we can actually start constraining the image of the black hole. Now, in 2017, we finally had for the first time an array that potentially can image the black hole. And this is because of the addition of a very powerful telescope in Chile. And it was amazing. We came together, we had a window of about 12 days, and we just have to hope that the weather actually cooperates, right? This is all the way from the South Pole to Hawaii, to Europe, to the United States, and it was just gorgeous weather. In all the 10 years that we've been observing, I've never seen weather like this. It was so good, actually, that we had to stop the observation after a few days because we were totally exhausted. And we had to just have a day of rest and continue. We're working on these data. I cannot show the images. I truly hope that we will have an image in about 6 months. But what is relevant here is for those, this kind of peak, we get signal to noises on these between telescopes of 700, which is close to actually unheard of. We're putting it to a very formal data analysis path that actually, different groups with different algorithms work, and you can see here the results of two algorithms, and they agree very well, just to make sure that we don't actually introduce biases. And ALMA, what ALMA does for us is shown here. This is actually between two telescopes, one in Hawaii and one in Spain. And you see very poor coherence. But both these telescopes, they work with this very sensitive telescope in Chile. And when you actually allow that to calibrate the telescopes, you can see suddenly this very nice coherence peak. So we get like a connectivity around the whole array. And this is what hopefully will get us to the point that we can get an image. Now, what will we see? Unfortunately, not all our simulations show us a beautiful image because we are suffering from at Sagittarius A star. This is not M87. Sagittarius A star, we actually, in our own galaxy, has its own variability. So basically on a day time scale, it is scattered by this interstellar medium. And then we have to use deblurring and algorithms and allow for the fact that we may not see it phase on, but edge on. And then sometimes we get images like these banana images. And it will take us like several epochs, so several times observing, and we co-add the data and we start slowly seeing the shadow. And this is unfortunate, I'm getting to the end of my talk. And this is, so I cannot promise you that the image will be very good. But this is a first step, and we will be actually improving this. How we're going to improve this is, in fact, if we get there, we're adding telescopes. So this year, we went back, we had awful weather, so, it kind of averages out. Greenland telescope was added, Kitt Peak. Next year, we will add a telescope in Arizona, possibly also in France. And we're working actually also to actively try to put telescope in spots. Oops. Where it will make a lot of difference to our network. We're going in Africa. If we put a telescope in Africa, it will create this beautiful connectivity across the Atlantic. So we're working on that. Ultimately, we want to go to higher frequencies. And that's what we're starting actually in October. And yet again, this will actually help us with overcoming this scattering. And thirdly, we want to actually go to space, and it shows you here. If we can go to 690 gigahertz, and this is the model, and this is actually what a simulation of the observation, not only is there no scattering anymore of that stuff that actually is between us and Sagittarius A star, it also, we get a much sharper image because the resolution becomes much better. You can see that we basically start recovering most of the structure that the simulation shows us, that even is washed out because of a limiting resolution at 230 gigahertz. Now, you say we want to send up 12 telescopes into space. That is impossible, but fortunately, we have a very clever people came up with this idea to send up two small dishes in space, and we just put them at 15,000 kilometer orbits, but we don't put them exactly in the same orbit. We put them like 50 or 100 meters apart. And over several months, 1 month or several months, depending on the orbit time scale, they will drift apart. And if you actually view this as sort of the virtual surface of a virtual, the surface of a virtual mirror that you're trying to create, it will extremely densely sample this virtual mirror that we try to create. It's now a 15,000 radius kilometer radius mirror, and that actually will allow us with a high fidelity to actually get shadows of images. And this is interesting because ultimately the shape of the shadow is fully determined by general relativity. And which means is that we can turn that around, and if we can parameterize and observe the shadow with enough precision, we can actually use it to test general relativity. We can make extensions to general relativity and see how that actually influences the shadow and compare it with the observations. Or we can actually use completely alternate theories of gravity and test those. That's basically it. I'm not sure. I have one more.
We have to stop. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. I have 47 second movie, and that's going to be shown. We're sitting outside. We see actually a black hole. So go ahead, Adri. We see actually a black hole powering up, and it will actually start having jets. And then as we sit around it, we will start flying into the accretion disk. And then hopefully we'll boost ourselves out, otherwise this will be indeed a very long talk. And we see what happens. It will look slightly strange, and this is because of the gravitational lensing effects. It doesn't actually feel like you're flying around when you're in the accretion disk, but trust me, you are. And these are just very sophisticated renderings. And they are also sort of the first step towards a dome-like movie that we'll hope to eventually produce. All right.